by Jamie Eisenberg at Jamie Eisenberg 8H ago 33 minutes read more week 5 start em amp sit em cheat sheet trade values things to know rankings streaming options waiver wire. This feels like a survival week for a lot of fantasy owners. We have a slew of injuries, and there are 4 teams on a bye. It might be a struggle filling out a quality starting lineup in competitive 12-team leagues. A larger Atlanta, Denver, New Orleans and Washington are off this week, and you know the stars who are missing from those teams. And we have to find replacement options for injured guys like Dalvin Cook, torn ACL, and Chris Carson, broken ankle, among others, which isn't exactly easy. If you're 0-4 or 13 in your league, you likely can't afford another loss if you want to make the playoffs. And those owners at 22 or better don't want to slip in the standings. The good news could be some struggling stars have the chance for a bounce back game in week 5, including our start of the week in JAJE. I also have confidence in disappointing players like Marshawn Lynch, Isaiah Crowell, T.Y. Hilton, and several more. Maybe if those players turn things around, then it might not be so bleak after all. And that would make all of us happy heading into week 5. Subscribe for free iTunes Stitcher Editor's Note. Projections are provided by CBS Sports and not Jamie Eisenberg. Start of the week AJ has been awful this season. You can make a case that Helps been the biggest fantasy bust through 4 weeks given his draft stock compared to his production. But now is not the time to give up on AJ. He's still going to be an elite fantasy running back, starting this week against the Titans. Ajayi opened the season with a solid first outing in Week 2 at the Chargers with 28 carries for 122 yards and 2 catches for 4 yards. But things have been messy since. In 2 games that were considered plus matchups against the Jets and Saints, Ajayi combined for just 23 carries for 62 yards and 3 catches for 17 yards. He's missed practice time with a knee issue, and the Dolphins' offense has been a mess with only 6 points scored the past 2 weeks. However, that will change in Week 5 against Tennessee. The Dolphins will finally play their first official home game against the Titans Week 1 versus Tampa Bay was postponed due to Hurricane Irma, and the Dolphins have played in Los Angeles, New York and London in the past 3 weeks, and that should help their outlook. The Titans are also playing their second road game in a row, and Marcus Mariota's hamstring is likely out. With Matt Castle under center, the Titans' offense should struggle, which should allow the Dolphins to control time of possession and lean on the ground game. And Tennessee has allowed a running back to score again at least 90 total yards in every game this season. Ajayi shouldn't follow suit. And this matchup in Week 5 last year was the game when Ajayi got going in his breakout campaign. He wasn't dominant against the Titans then with just 13 carries for 42 yards and a touchdown, but he scored 10 fantasy points in a standard league. And he followed that up with 3 games in a row with at least 100 rushing yards and a touchdown, including 2 games with at least 200 yards. I'm not suggesting the same thing will happen after this game. I'm just focused on this week. And while Ajayi has been a fantasy disappointment thus far, this should be his breakout game of 2017. Don't give up on him yet. I'm starting Ajayi over LeSean McCoy at CIN, Carlos Hyde at IND, Jordan Howard versus Min, DeMarco Murray at MIA and Lamar Miller versus KC quarterback sleepers Carson Palmer at FI. I don't love Palmer on the East Coast for a 1 p.m. start, but he should be good for at least 18 fantasy points. He's done that in consecutive games, and he's passed for at least 300 yards in 3 games in a row. The Eagles also have struggled in the past 3 games against Smith, Manning and Philip Rivers and are allowing 20.5 fantasy points on average to opposing quarterbacks this year. Jay Cutler versus 10. I'm expecting Cutler to benefit this week from being home and facing a terrible defense for the Titans. After 3 games on the road, Cutler gets his first official game in Miami, and Tennessee should help him rebound from 2 awful starts against the Jets and Saints. The Titans are allowing an average of 29 fantasy points per game to opposing quarterbacks, and I consider Cutler a low end starting option this week. Jacoby Brissett versus SF. The last time Brissett was at home in a favorable matchup was against the Browns in Week 3, and he scored 29 fantasy points. We hope he follows suit this week against the 49ers. Now, San Francisco has only allowed 1 quarterback to score 20 fantasy points this year, which was Jared Goff in Week 4, but the 49ers are averaging 19.5 points on average to quarterbacks. Brissett, like Josh McCone and Brian Hoyer, is a good streaming option in week 5, bust alert for what it's worth. I've been wrong about Newton the past 2 weeks. He was bad as the start of the week in week 3 against New Orleans and awesome at New England in week 4. But did Newton do enough in last week's 38-point performance against the Patriots, who have been the worst defense in the NFL through 4 games, to warrant being a must-start quarterback again? This is a tougher defense he's facing against the Lions, who are allowing just 12.5 fantasy points on average to opposing quarterbacks, including matchups with Palmer, Manning and Ryan. This is the second consecutive road game for Newton, and he combined for just 33 fantasy points in his first 3 games against San Francisco, Buffalo and New Orleans. I certainly understand keeping Newton in your starting lineup with a hope he can build off what he did last week. But I expect a letdown game for him this week on the road. Running back sleepers. Alex Collins at OKC's averaging 8.2 yards per carry on just 25 carries in the past 3 games, and he deserves more work, especially ahead of Terrence West and Javorius Allen. This is a game where the Ravens can control time of possession, which should lend to Baltimore running the ball more, and the Raiders have allowed a running back to gain at least 90 total yards in 3 games in a row. Andre Ellington at Fi Ellington looks like a must-start running back in PPR leagues with his performance over the past 2 games, and that should NT change this week. He has 14 catches for 145 yards on 22 targets against Dallas and San Francisco, and Ellington should get more work than Chris Johnson until David Johnson wrist returns. Wayne Gallman vs. Lack. Paul Perkins' ribs could play this week, which would ruin the upside for Gallman after a strong showing in week 4 against the Buccaneers when he had 11 carries for 42 yards and 2 catches for 8 yards and a touchdown on 2 targets. Even if Perkins plays, the Giants should lean on Gallman in a positive matchup against the Chargers. 4 running backs have scored at least 12 fantasy points against the Chargers in the past 3 games. James White at TB. The Buccaneers have struggled with pass-catching running backs this year, and 3 guys have already scored at least 5 fantasy points in standard leagues with their production in the passing game against Tampa Bay with Tarik Cohen, Cook and Gallman. White is obviously better in PPR leagues, and he has 2 games with at least 8 catches in the past 3 weeks. I'm expecting Tom Brady to lean on White a lot in this matchup, and he's a flex option in standard leagues and a solid starting option in PPR. Bust alert. Abdullah was excellent in week 4 at Minnesota, and I hope that's a sign of things to come because I'm excited about him for this season. He had 20 carries for 94 yards and a touchdown and 3 catches for 50 yards against a good Vikings defense, but I'm nervous that a letdown is coming this week. While the workload has been great for Abdullah this year, he has at least 17 touches in every game. He only has 1 game with double digits in fantasy points in a standard league, which was last week. And the Panthers are a tough opponent, with no running back scoring double digits in fantasy points against them in a standard league this year, including matchups with Carlos Hyde and LeSean McCoy. I'm okay with Abdullah as a flex option, but he's not a must-start running back for me this week. Wide receiver sleepers. Adam Thielen at Kai Thielen's done a nice job for owners in PPR leagues with 5 catches in every game this season, but he's still looking for his first touchdown. That could happen this week since the Bears have allowed 6 touchdowns to receivers and 4 to score double digits in fantasy points in a standard league. Jerron Brown at Fi Brown has done a nice job each of the past 3 games with at least 7 fantasy points in a standard league in each outing. He has 29 targets over that span, and Palmer is leaning on him as the number 2 receiver behind Larry Fitzgerald. Brown is facing an Eagles defense this week that has allowed 4 receivers to score at least 13 fantasy points in a standard league. Danny Amendola at TB. Amendola has played in 3 games this season, and he has 7 targets in 2 of them. In those games, he has 6 catches and has scored 10 fantasy points in both outings. This could be a game where Tom Brady leans on guys like Amendola, White and Rob Gronkowski, and Amendola is worth using as a low-end starting option in every format. Cooper Kupp versus C-Cup has 3 games this season with at least 6 targets, and he's scored at least 12 fantasy points in 2 of them, including week 4 at Dallas with 5 catches for 60 yards and a touchdown on 7 targets. Seattle has been vulnerable to slot receivers this year, and cornerback Jeremy Lane Groen is banged up. It could be another solid outing for Cup in week 5. Jermaine Curse at CLE. Curse has cooled off recently following a hot start, but he remains the number 1 receiver for the Jets. and the number one receiver opposite Cleveland has done well this year, with Antonio Brown, Jeremy Maclin, Hilton, and AJ Green all scoring at least 9 fantasy points in a standard league. Kurse is a number 3 fantasy receiver in week 5, bust alert as you can see, I'm not expecting a big game from the Carolina Panthers this week, and Benjamin is another player who could let you down given the matchup with the Lions. He is expected to see plenty of coverage from Detroit's standout cornerback Darius Slay, and no number 1 receiver has scored against the Lions this year, including matchups with Fitzgerald, Beckham, Julio Jones and Stephon Diggs. Now, Jones and Diggs both had at least 91 receiving yards, but Benjamin has one game this season above that total, which was last week against the Patriots. And he's also still looking for his first touchdown this year. Benjamin is only a number 3 fantasy receiver this week. Tight end sleepers Evan Engram versus Lack Engram hasn't had a big game yet, but he's on the verge of that happening given his targets. He has 25 targets in his past 3 games, and he's come down with 15 catches for 156 yards and a touchdown over that span. He faces a Chargers defense this week that hasn't allowed a touchdown to a tight end this season, but Engram still has top 10 potential, especially in PPR. Benjamin Watson at Oak Watson didn't have a great game in week 4 against Pittsburgh with 5 catches for 43 yards on 6 targets, but he's still been heavily involved in the offense, which should not change this week. And he's facing a Raiders defense that has allowed a tight end to score at least 7 fantasy points in a standard league in 3 of 4 games this year. Hunter Henry at NYG Henry and Antonio Gates are both sleeper options this week given the matchup with the Giants, who have allowed 5 touchdowns to tight ends this year and at least 1 in each game. Henry finally scored his first touchdown of the season last week against the Eagles. Bust alert Rudolph definitely misses Sam Bradford knee. In week 1 with Bradford on the field, Rudolph had 3 catches for 26 yards and a touchdown on 3 targets. Unfortunately, that was his best game of the season. Since then, in 3 games with Case Keenum, Rudolph has combined for 7 catches for 83 yards and no touchdowns on 12 targets. He should struggle again this week against the Bears, who gave up 2 big catches to Austin Hooper in week 1 but have been tough against opposing tight ends since. We would avoid Rudolph if possible this week. Defensive special teams start M. Jets at CLE 14.5 projected points. This is a play against Kaiser and the Browns offense as much as trusting the Jets DST, but they've played well the past 2 weeks and are worth using as a streaming option in week 5. In the past 2 games against Miami and Jacksonville, the Jets have allowed a late garbage time touchdown to the Dolphins at the end of regulation and just 1 offensive touchdown to the Jaguars. Now, they only have 3 turnovers and 6 sacks for the year, but Kaiser already has 8 interceptions, 1 fumble and has been sacked 11 times. Cleveland has scored fewer than 20 points in 3 of 4 games, and the Jets DST has a good chance to finish as a number 1 unit this week. Sleeper DST's Eagles vs. Ari Palmer has been hit a lot, and he's been sacked 16 times in the past 3 games. Arizona has also scored fewer than 20 points in 3 games in a row. The Eagles DST has only averaged 6.0 fantasy points per game over the past 3 weeks, but this is a good week to trust them in a home matchup with the Cardinals. Giants vs. Lack. The Giants DST has yet to score 10 fantasy points in a game this year, and they've generated just 2 fumbles with no interceptions through 4 games, along with only 8 sacks. Rivers has only thrown 4 interceptions and been sacked 6 times, but I'm expecting him to struggle this week on the road. The Giants DST has the chance to be a solid top 10 unit in this matchup. Lions vs. Carr. The Panthers turned things around last week against the Patriots, but in the 3 previous games against the 49ers, Bills and Saints, the opposing DSTs combined for 40 fantasy points. Newton has been sacked 12 times and has 6 interceptions on the season, and the Lions DST has scored at least 14 fantasy points in 4 games in a row. It's time for you to buy into the Lions DST as a weekly starter in all leagues. Sit M. Jaguars at Pitt 10.0 projected points. The Jaguars DST has been phenomenal this year, and they come into this game with at least 17 fantasy points in 3 of 4 games, with 2 games scoring at least 20 points. but the Steelers allow the sixth fewest fantasy points to opposing DSTs, and the Bears in Week 3 are the only DST to score more than 7 fantasy points against the Steelers. If this game was in Jacksonville, then I would consider using the Jaguars DST, but in Pittsburgh you should expect the Steelers offense to play at a high level as always. Kickers start Tim Elliott needs to be owned in all leagues because he's been amazing the past 3 weeks. Sure, a letdown is coming, but Elliott is averaging nearly 12 fantasy points a game since becoming the Eagles kicker in Week 2. He's 8 of 10 on field goals, including 2 from 50-plus yards, and he's made all 7 of his extra points. The Cardinals have already allowed 2 kickers to make multiple field goals this year, including Phil Dawson last week when he made 5 field goals. Elliott should continue to be a difference maker for fantasy owners in Week 5. Sleeper kickers Greg Zuerlein vs. See the Seahawks have allowed 2 kickers to make at least 3 field goals already and score at least 9 fantasy points, and Zuerlein has been awesome this season with 14 of 14 field goals and 14 of 14 made extra points. He's scored at least 11 fantasy points in 3 of 4 games this year. Harrison Butker at Hell Butker did well in his first game for the Chiefs in Week 4 against Washington with 3 of 4 made field goals and 2 made extra points. The Texans haven't allowed a field goal in the past 2 games against New England and Tennessee, but in their first 2 games, Jason Myers and Randy Bullock combined for 6 field goals and 2 extra points. Butker should be a solid fantasy kicker this week. Kymie Fairbairn vs. KC Fairbairn has been great for the past 2 games with 32 combined fantasy points against the Patriots and Titans. And he's made 7 field goals and 9 extra points over that span. The Chiefs have allowed multiple field goals in 3 games already this year, and Fairbairn should once again finish as a number 1 fantasy kicker this week. Sit Mgano has been solid so far this year, and he's scored at least 9 fantasy points in 3 of 4 games. But I'm expecting him to have minimal production this week against the Lions' stingy defense. Only Matt Bryant in Week 3 made multiple field goals against Detroit, and Bryant is the lone kicker with more than 5 fantasy points. Garno will likely score single digits in fantasy points this week and is not worth starting in this matchup on the road.